everyone, and welcome again to our lecture series, The Power of Place, Globalization and Local Identities. I'm Eleni Bastea, and I'm the director of the International Studies Institute. And this series of lectures was co-organized with my colleague, Dr. Amina Tawasso, and myself. We're very thankful to the many programs that have contributed and made this a reality, specifically the New Mexico Humanities Council and the National Endowment for the Humanities, as well as the University of New Mexico, that includes the Office of the Provost, the Office of Academic Affairs, the College of Arts and Sciences, departments of English, of History, the Religious Studies Program, American Studies, the School of Architecture and Planning, the Geospatial Institute, and the Center for English Language and Culture, CELAC, and as well as other groups, and we'll be posting all of that up on our website, isi.umn.edu. It's great to see old and new friends. And it is a special honor and a deep pleasure to welcome to UNM again our friend, colleague, and architectural theory and history professor, Dr. Alberto Perez Gomez. And for those of you who are familiar also with the last name at UNM, his brother, Jorge Perez Gomez, directs the UNM orchestra. So we have music and architecture, which is probably a good way to introduce Alberto's latest book, Attunement, Bringing Music and Architecture Together. Architectural Meaning After the Crisis of Modern Science. And you can also purchase it right after the lecture from our bookstore table outside. Alberto teaches history and theory, runs the history theory program at McGill University, and he's the author of several books. I think for most of us, Architecture and the Crisis of Modern Science was the book that put his name on our radar screen. And several books followed, including Architecture and the Perspective Hinge with Louis Pelletier. In 2006, he published a book, Built Upon Love, which we used as a seminar book with some of you who are in the audience today. And 2 years ago, he came and lectured from that material to the university twice. And as I mentioned more recently, the book Attunement came out with MIT Press, but also two volumes called Timely Meditations that include several essays he's written over the years. You're here to hear Alberto and not myself. Please help us welcome him again to UNF.
Thank you, Lenny. Too many microphones, too many cables. Let's try to make this work first. So can you hear me in the back?
Yes.
It's okay? Okay. Thank you, Eleni, very, very much. Thank you for having me here. Thank you for the invitation to this remarkable series, actually. I am honored to be in such company, and I was telling you this afternoon how proud you must be at UNM to be able to organize something like this, because really you have the best people, some of the best minds in the world talking about this question of place. Basically the two for most important philosophers of place in North America and the Southern Hemisphere, Edward Casey and Jeff Malpass, both are kind, very nice friends of mine that will be here. So I think it's remarkable. And I am honored. So thank you to you and to the International Studies Institute for this nice opportunity. So what I want to do is, you will hear a lot about place, of course, during these seminars, and I'm sure my philosopher friends will be able to tell you more clearly how place is primary for being. So place is crucial to understand, you know, philosophical questions, ontological questions. My interest, of course, is also philosophical, but I will try to bring this to you through the discipline of architecture, which is my own concern, and to try to understand how this vexing problem, because it's actually a difficult problem, to try to think about place, to be able to understand how one can conceptualize it and make it productive for architecture, right? I mean, that because that's really the question, being an architect, teaching architects, that's the way that I frame the question. So I know that you probably come here from other disciplines as well, and I wanted to paraphrase my words by saying this so that you know what to expect. So, precisely because of that, I wish to land my discussion, starting it right away, by revisiting Christian Norberg Schulze's use of the concept of genius loci, the genius or the spirit of place. Because within our discipline, and I'm not going to make a long history of this problem, because it has a long history going back to debates between Aristotle and Plato, I won't get into that here today, between place and space. But in the short history of our discipline, he has to be granted the honor, if you like, of making the discipline aware of the importance of place for architectural production. His works were published around 1970s, right? So we're talking about already last century. But he is the beginning of the story for us. So I wanted to start to talk a little bit about him and to tell you how important he is, but also how perhaps he came short. So his contribution was significant in the wake of modernism, just after modernism, particularly to foreground the limitations and fallacies of the so-called international style of architecture. You know, this assumption that architects in the 1960s, 70s, even 50s had, that you could have a way to solve functional problems and land them wherever in the universe, wherever in the world, with no concern for place or local identity. So he starts from this problem, and he foregrounds, for the first time ever, this issue of the importance of the spirit of the place. Of course, genius loci is Latin, right? Genius, geni, is the spirit. Locus is place. So this was a crucial concept for him during the 1970s and in his later work, where he basically became interested in existential phenomenology. His identification, so he's actually trying to recover this from Heidegger, if you want the his own reference. Its identification in historical contexts of the genius of place becoming a proof of architecture's meaning for Norberg Schulze. He writes, for example, Prague, the city of Prague in the Czech Republic, seizes you, he says, and remains with you as hardly any other place. This closeness of the earth, the strength of Prague as a place, depends first of all on the felt presence of the genius loci throughout. The language is unquestionably moving and evocative of experience. In his books, however, this spirit, and it's interesting underscore the word spirit, because I will be actually talking about that. Spirit, spiritus, is the breath. The breath is the atmosphere. It connects to atmos. But he uses it, you know, it's interesting. For him, this spirit is transmitted to the reader through first black and white photography, and only in later editions, color photography. Very carefully done, very carefully framed and edited. Genius loci came to stand for architects for an appropriate identification of context as a setting and point of departure for meaningful contemporary design practices. Now, we really have to ask, how is this spirit of place given? Is the embodiment of a tradition, this identity, hermetic to the alien, to the newly arrived immigrants, for example? Is it objective, like a picture, transparent in its representation, like the photographs ingenious loci seem to suggest? Or I can ask rhetorically, and this will be, of course, the topic of my lecture, does it in fact demand a transformation of our self-understanding and our understanding of perception in order to grasp its scope? It is a fact that the concept of genius loci by postmodern architects in the 1980s resulted in a fiasco, creating much more than pastiche. If the place could be represented as a picture, it takes little imagination to claim that its genius loci could certainly be recreated, like in Charles Moore's Piazza d'Italia. Sorry, I'm one slide behind. This is actually one of the photographs of the early editions of genius loci showing the Hatshepsut tomb in Egypt with a quote by Norbert Schulz, right? But this is where I am. So, like in Charles Moore, Piazza d'Italia in New Orleans. Yes, this is really what, unfortunately, how the misapplication of this awareness right at the outset. This urban project, as I'm sure many of you know, has remained problematic and actually practically ignored by the inhabitants of this amazing city, because it's one of the good cities in North America, you know, that has, in the United States, that has really qualities, atmospheric qualities, became very problematic since its inception. How may architecture and urban form more authentically acknowledge then the specific cultural particularities that we associate with the identity of place? The failures of postmodernism led to a reaction, now exemplified by the new avant-garde and to statements such as Rem Koolhaas, who has claimed that such connections between identity and place are more or less a delusion. Since the strategies of postmodernism failed, does this mean that anything goes instead? Does this give license to these star architects to build branded projects anywhere in the world, regardless of cultural milieu? This is evidently a central question for an ethical contemporary architecture that respects and embraces cultural differences. In my view, the question is crucial, but it is inherently ambiguous. Contrary to what many architects and critical theorists may think, contextualism is not an obvious operation, particularly when one may recognize that what is at stake is not the production of novel objects, but the design of attuned atmospheres. This is interesting, yes, because this really recalls, of course, the question of spiritus for diverse cultural habits and practices. The question is even more complex, as one must recognize that artistic products from the most diverse cultures seem to have the capacity to touch us by virtue of their paradoxical universality, a universality that actually emerges from their profound cultural specificity. It's really a logical paradox, right? They both belong to a time and place, that I'm talking about artistic artifacts, and transcend it, contributing to human self-understanding. The difficulties around this question are a direct result of a typically modern cultural dilemma, namely the challenge of imagining and building meaningful architecture and urban environments for a globalized world civilization that, regardless of geographical location, remains in the grip of Cartesian dualism, identifying it with common sense. Descartes believed that in order to bridge the divide between the human mind and the world, our vision should depend upon precise perspective pictures. Thus, geometrical perspective was identified with the truth of the world. All other sensory dimensions were potential distractions or ruses. Philosopher Martin Heidegger thought this reduction of reality to a perspectival picture, in fact, revealed an inherent incapacity to perceive the context of objects. It ignored, in other words, the Aristotelian insight, this Aristotle, that when an object changes place, it actually modifies its being. This visual manifestation of the technological mentality posed the gravest dangers to our world, reducing the world to pictures, bringing about the hegemony of the image. Descartes' dualistic world has made the global village possible, one in which concepts of reality and delusions of progress are fueled by the evident successes of technology in controlling and dominating the environment. In this predominantly scientistic world, the great majority of building reflects little else but enshrined, supposedly objective and hedonistic values of economy and efficiency. Such architecture instantiates, like a signpost, monetary and political power. In order to design and build a poetic world, both grounded in a culture and also transcending it, a world that may enable humans to participate in a sense of meaning without reducing buildings to literal signs, we must, in fact, question certain deep-rooted assumptions. First of all, architecture is not the mere manipulation of form or space. It is neither an art nor a science in a reduced sense of the terms. Understanding our profession this way, we will never grasp what belongs in a site or what is appropriate to the given set of focal actions to which architecture must give place and that we call the architectural program. The ultimate relativity of value is insurmountable if architecture is reduced to a question of aesthetics in the 18th century sense, ornament or style in the 19th century sense. Positions for and against the importance and precedence of a given cultural milieu are equally false if one understands such a milieu to a picture, if one equates such a milieu to a picture, or as a materialistic, dead, and objectified collection of physical features or buildings. Such context, in quotation marks, in inverted commas, can never be the origin for the generation of meaningful architectural ideas and built work. There is, of course, a noble desire in reaction to the banality of technological modernism to relate certain urban architecture either to landscape, to one specific architectural tradition, or both. Think, for example, of so-called Pueblo-style architecture in Santa Fe, or the example that I have here, this desire to modernize a certain contextual appreciation of Amsterdam in the slide on the right. This is the call that was articulated by Norbert Schulz. He writes, "Even in our global epoch, the spirit of place remains a reality. Human identity presupposes the identity of place, and the genius loci, therefore, ought to be understood and preserved." Context, as an objectified, picture-like, lifeless form in the sense sketched above, however, is far from a synonym of either nature or cultural heritage, and cannot be a point of departure for a more rooted architecture. It is interesting to point out that even Heidegger, usually identified with kind of conservative impulse towards rootedness and stable identity that characterizes Norbert Schulz's theoretical works, you know, Norbert Schulz actually often quotes Heidegger as his main source, even Heidegger insisted in his late works on the transitory character of life and cultural worlds, arguing that we continually remain within homelessness and attempted homecoming. These are words from late Heidegger. To grasp the significance of both our given natural world and our histories as the ground for a distinct architecture, we must understand these phenomena as interwoven, only graspable through narratives, which also enable our self-understanding as modern architects. So this is rather key for me. This is a hermeneutic imagination, and is indeed, in my opinion, the only sure foundation that may allow the architect to articulate a project as a political position, following an understanding of what may be appropriate here and now in view of a certain task. Key to this problem is the issue of language. Language, contrary to what architects generally believe, is crucial for a poetic and ethical practice. Language, many have argued, is the substance of the imagination and the crucial foundation for constructing real commonplace. Language is the basis of phronesis, or prudence, you can also call it wisdom, the practical philosophy of Aristotle, the ground of cultures, that is also the ground of truly relevant human truths, including concepts like the good and the beautiful. The nature of such truth is, of course, unlike the truth of as correspondence that we associate with mathematics, and closer to the Heideggerian concept of aletheia, which is indeed a modern Greek word for truth, you know. Aletheia, are you kidding me? True, right? An event of unconcealment. Contemporary architects have a tendency to bypass language, believing that the imagination, creativity, and the project identified with picture making can occupy some universal realm that allows for ubiquity to be anywhere. In this way, we may feel we are perfectly capable of designing in New York a school for Uganda, for example, fulfilling an abstract brief provided by a client, for seemingly what matters is an international language of forms made possible by universal technological means. Stories are crucial for an ethical praxis, for a design professional to state where she stands. History and context are never simply given like unchanging objects. I guess that's beginning to be my punchline. We have to make them at every moment because understanding is interpretation. And our conceptual skills and background are very much part of our perception, which is never passive. We weave them in the present through our own desire, these interpretations. And we must do this with humility, in an exchange with the culture in which we expect to build. Genuine dialogue, a fusion or confluence of horizons, is paramount. Only when emerging from the deeply rooted language of a particular culture can an appropriate position be formulated, resulting in a program and eventually an appropriate architectural project. As Friedrich Nietzsche suggested in the 19th century, history is the most authentic knowledge we possess in a post-cosmological era, if we wish to act creatively, to take a position and make a promise. History is our full inheritance. It comprises both the constitution of the mental framework that has its roots in the Western tradition, philosophical and scientific tradition, for the contemporary world, technological world, is constituted out of that tradition, and at a different register, the local architectural artifacts that are cultural symbols made by others asking questions kindred to ours. Artifacts through which we can glean an order allowing our present orientation. we should seek basic strategies for poetic inhabitation in the artifacts, history, and fictions that constitute our background and that of the cultures for whom we build. This is, of course, far from being a call for a simple return to the vernacular. So let me foreground, through a few examples, some aspects of experience that emerge from a phenomenological appreciation of context that will lead to the, hopefully, a more proper understanding of how place can be conceptualized and made productive for architecture. It has been observed, it's one, you know, it can, there are many, that could give many examples, but it has been observed that the perception of invariant colors and dimensions in the empirical world is bound to specific cultures through language. The Inuit in my country, in the polar desert, for example, perceive many colors where we see only white. Yet the perception of invariance, however it may occur, is a secondary phenomenon, while unquestionably the flow of experience itself is primary. Pure blue, white, red are never empirical facts in our perceptual experience. They always appear situated as qualities of particular phenomena in a field, and of course, under a certain light. Similarly, a vertical dimension is always perceived as larger than the horizontal dimension of the same quantitative extension. This is not an optical illusion. We will invariably overestimate the horizontal distance a falling tower may reach, because vertical distance is, in fact, in the first instance, greater than horizontal distance. What we perceive as primary is always elastic. Time and distance depending, for instance, on whether we go home from school or the office riding a bicycle or in a fast car, and depending on whether we are hungry or bored. The mileage reading in the car odometer is, in this sense, a secondary abstraction. Thus, if we turn to architecture and think of, you know this, right? Even a first-year student would recognize it, I think, St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. We may choose to objectify it, as you know, the building, the St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, as art historians often do in their texts, and state, for instance, and it's often done, that its proportions, particularly the proportions of the facade, are actually awkward and squat, ignoring that Bernini's oval piazza makes it look amazing and right. Such intellectualizing objectifications of architecture constitute a dangerous fallacy. Notice, for example, in the argument of the art historians that the objectified, contextless building is taken as the real building, allowing the critic to utter such a scathing judgment. This is a bad piece of architecture, except that somehow it works in the context. Right? It's like inverting, turning the thing upside down. Because ultimately, where would we have a St. Peter's Basilica without its context? Only in somebody's mind. St. Peter's Basilica is what it is in its existing site. The work never exists outside or apart from its context, even though we may wish to consider it as an autonomous geometrical object in the Cartesian space of our mind. Furthermore, the context that contributes so much to its identity is never purely the objectified, measurable site either. The site, we could say, has a site. It is perceived through the body, our body, whose awareness always includes pre-reflective consciousness. Thus, we must conclude that context is indeed crucial for architectural meaning. No matter what we put out there, situatedness comes first. yet must be understood in its more encompassing sense as situation or ground, or even as the world of the work. It also follows that the issue of the generation of appropriate architectural ideas in an urban site or region of the modern world is a complex problem that depends on the proper working of the imagination, reconciling what is given with what is possible in order to open up the possibility of poetic dwelling. It is therefore a problem of metaphoricity. It necessitates rhetorical and political thinking, and not instrumental or stylistic deduction. Only an architect with broad cultural understanding and roots in the humanities is liable to succeed in this task. As we know well, these are conditions that unfortunately do not respond to the pedagogical priorities of contemporary architecture schools driven crazy by accreditation lists and professional corporations. The modern world has a specific reality that is not independent from our consciousness. The world itself is an intentional phenomenon, and our place in history as modern humans demands that our actions not become curtailed by a reactionary enslavement within prevailing traditions when these become empty of content. Martin Heidegger, who helped, of course, fundamentally to establish the phenomenological awareness at the root of my previous remarks, and also, you know, at the root of Edward Casey and Jeff Malpas, that you will be hearing in this series, about the importance of the site as place, he also writes, I'm quoting him here because it's very important, eh? And you can ask my philosopher friends about it, what they think. So Heidegger writes, "The flight into tradition, out of a combination of humility and prescription, can bring about nothing in itself other than self-deception and blindness in relation to the historical moment." So, architectural historians have contributed to a delusion when they falsely try to explain the development of architecture as progressive organic change. The great architecture that we now perceive as our tradition or our traditions, is in fact the work of enlightened individuals whose highly personal and imaginative syntheses were never contextual in the modern, narrow sense of the word. These works were at the leading edge of culture at the time they were created. I mean, think for example of, the Santa Sindone Chapel by Guarino Guarini in Turin, right? For instance, they fit into the culture and the natural environment, not because they were formally coherent, but rather because their identity, that which they represented, and that allowed their builders and inhabitants a deep sense of recognition, was the result of the individual architect's broad and deep cultural roots in his own space-time. This is at the heart of architectural meaning, always perceived as both new and familiar, both new and also familiar, enabling the participatory role of the work. Our traditional sense of place or locus has been disrupted by our belief that technological, isotropic, geometric space can be the real domain of our worldly actions. Australian philosopher Jeff Malpas grants that while place is fundamental and primary to existence, it has been occulted or hidden by our concepts of geometric space. Our age supports an almost blind faith in applied science, one that has become increasingly international and transcultural, fueled by ever more efficient systems of communication and information, blurring traditional boundaries and with them the qualities of specific places that may still be present in everyday modern life. This is a reality that must be acknowledged by architects and urban designers. In other words, let me emphasize this, please, the recovery of place is a critical project. It is not enough to look at the world or region transformed into a picture. Cultural values and relations to place must be sought in architecture through a personal search, a work of the ethical imagination, and not of pastiche or statistics. It really must, what I mean is, has to be really internalized by the architect in this case. To expect that one can isolate regional or cultural formal characteristics and reflect them in architecture through a conscious, externalized operation is naive. Equally futile is the desire to recreate nostalgic urban public space, for example. A square or parallelogram with four little trees does not make a piazza or a plaza. Postmodern simulations are not the modern equivalent of the locus where traditional architecture fulfilled its intersubjective cultural promise to become a cosmic space, offering through experiential wonder a ground and orientation to our finite lives. This kind of contextualism, regionalism, or even revivalism has clearly failed to produce truly meaningful architecture, even when it may rival the surrogate forms of cultural participation represented by the media, cyberspace, or television. What then are our alternatives? From the historical trajectory of modernity, we have also inherited a very real capacity for reaction and personal reconciliation. The history of this alternative poetic epistemology started with the Romantic movement in philosophy and continued in the 20th century, mainly through surrealism and phenomenology. Making architecture with a desire to acknowledge local identity, we must recognize the priority of embodiment and our connections to the natural world. And yet, neither the world nor the body are simply given unmediated as a permanent and unchanging essence. Our conceptual skills can actually modify our perceptions, enriching or impoverishing them. You know the example of that psychologists often use, this little video clip that you can get from the internet, you know, where there is they tell you, look at the players playing basketball, look at the ball. Look, concentrate on how they are passing the ball, but pay only attention to how they are passing the ball. And then in the middle of the clip, there comes a guy dressed as a gorilla, you know, walking from one side to the other of the field of the camera. You don't see it. You only see the gorilla when you know, when you are told, look, there's gonna be, look, are you paying attention? I don't know, you probably are aware of this. This is how really conceptual skills modify perception. It's really problem. It's the real problem of phenomenology really to deal with this. Because perception is primary, but conceptual skills really modify perception. That's why it's not so easy just to say, look, let's just become touchy-feely about place. Right? It's really a critical project. Meditating upon an artificial lake created by planners many years ago in the middle of Dallas, this great thinker, Ivan Illich, speaks how difficult it is for H2O, a modern fluid whose function since the late 18th century has been to circulate in cities, to truly appear as elemental water, you know, as one of the four Aristotelian elements. Under those, if once you know that it's H2O, it's not so easy for water to appear as elemental, right? As the mythical liquid that not only makes life possible, which it still does, but allows for remembering and forgetting if you know classical mythology. In arid regions where water is scarce, for example, this observation is crucial because while it is important to conserve H2O, and to procure the amounts needed for practical purposes, it is even more fundamental to remember that its symbolic value can only be recovered through imaginative work. Let's say displacement and metaphor. While, of course, waste must be avoided, the problem of our humanity will not be solved by shutting down a few fountains. Life will be made worse if a potential for true poetry, for example, is eliminated. We have been severed from our traditions and an architecture capable of disclosing places cannot be the outcome of a simple-minded extrapolation from historical or autochthonous vernacular buildings. The theory of functionalism obviously failed, becoming prey to its own reductionist obsessions. And yet, almost regardless of what architects themselves may have said or written about their work, true modern architecture has been produced that is not identical to technological building. Now, it's interesting to think about what this architecture is about. Yeah? Architecture that has unquestionable emotional meaning, and it's all diverse and heterogeneous. If you think, for example, I have just a few examples here, Gaudí's Casa Mila, Aalto's Pamio Sanatorium, or Villa Mairea, Mies Barcelona Pavilion, Le Corbusier's La Tourette, or Ronchamp. Regardless of its style, and in this case, all the styles of these architectural, modern architecture examples is different, or of its more or less figural or abstract quality, such architecture allows for cultural recognition. It creates atmospheres, indeed, a spirit, right, that welcome our dreams. It represents our values in a mode ultimately irreducible to paraphrase. Contrary to common assumptions, this architecture is profoundly meaningful precisely because it does not have one single meaning, like the logo of a company or a false idol, and rather opposes all strong dogmatic and ideological reductions. Perhaps we should emphasize this further. Barragán's architecture does not represent Mexico as a nation state. The same could be said for Aalto and Finland, or Le Corbusier for France. This coupling is one of the most problematic misunderstandings of regionalism. As Giorgio Agamben has clearly explained, nation states are modern fabrications often held together by police control. True architecture always overwhelms its simple function as sign and plays with power. This is why it is crucial for humanity's survival. We, of course, expect to be at home in our cities, to share a sense of existential and not merely physical security. Yet our collective home must accept a dimension of utopia, one that accompanies the true values of modernity, the possibility of real historical evolution and our self-assertion as individuals, leaving behind the repugnant prejudices of the past and transcending both totalitarianism and anarchy. We must therefore embrace the positive aspects of utopia, of a better future, while remaining open to the gifts of our cultural region, particularly as made manifest in artifacts of many kinds, literary and artistic. It is my contention that within this tradition of poetic artifacts in different media, we may find appropriate strategies to be internalized and tested by the architect seeking to produce an architecture that reveals place. Abstract architectural ideas evidently pose a danger of being easy to assimilate to the aims of technological domination. The power of the modern architect as a maker, however, should not be denied. The great works of modern architecture, even though they are in the world and belong to culture, like gestures or food, right, are comparatively free from the traditional limitations and associations of the specific site. This, of course, does not mean that these works simply ignore their place. On the contrary, I would argue, when successful, architecture unveils the sense of place and returns it to us as that which has been always there, always given, as the gift of consciousness itself. Only by acknowledging this difficulty will we be able to transcend the danger of solipsism and irrelevance in architectural practice. Let me reiterate. There is obviously no creation out of nothing. You know, that's a Christian myth, Judeo-Christian myth. Phenomenology proclaims that the world co-emerges with consciousness and gives it its meanings. The world co-emerges with consciousness and gives it its meanings. In this sense, the artist reveals the unnameable through the poetic image, the invisible and concealed deep reality of our human world. since perception itself is action and is never passive, the old dualistic distinction between nature and culture becomes ambivalent. The structure of ground, sky, and horizon, to which the poet and architect must allude, is of course always present. Yet in our technological world, place can no longer be simply disclosed through a mimetic imagination. It has to be produced through a hermeneutic one. This operation is first gestural and linguistic, even, I would say, dramatic, rather than simply a question of pictures. To repeat, suggesting that we can recognize purely material qualities, typological, topological, or morphological, at each one of the different scales addressed by the planner or architect, in order to build a figural building or city in a supposedly identifiable place with this particular spirit, is a delusion. It is a delusion that can be particularly dangerous when extrapolated to the political realm. In a world where we are called to live with others, hoping to preserve our own autochthonous cultures, but remaining open to newcomers, it is indeed of the essence to understand that cultural identity is fundamentally impossible to objectify. It does not live through signs like swastikas or crucifixes, but through open symbolic artifacts and actions, more akin, I would claim, to Byzantine icons than to pagan idols, because Byzantine icons, as philosopher Jean-Luc Marion reminds us, were meant to allow meanings to appear through them without circumscribing them. Dwelling in the early third millennium demands a reinvention of the ground of architecture by identifying first our renewed non-Cartesian body image and its particular and necessarily fragmented recollection of being. Through an introspective search in the form of self-knowledge through making, the architect can then expect to generate an order appropriate to the task and site. The search is a personal one, and in this sense, is intimately related to the search of the painter, the writer, or the musician. A search always oriented by a historical sense, by the identification of a founding tradition. As in Rothko's dark canvases that are in this Rothko Chapel in Houston, that I hope you have had the opportunity to visit. If not, you should go. The embodiment of the archetypal, those canvases are landscapes. The embodiment of the archetypal landscape is today perhaps closer to the universal than, say, in the works of an 18th century painter, landscape painter. Yet it remains uniquely concrete, immediately transformative, and equally impossible to paraphrase. To conclude, finally, let me briefly return to the crucial role of language that I had alluded to in all of this, the language of metaphor, of course. As a language against the conventional denotative function of prose or pictures, capable of expressing for us the character of a place, a city, or a region. But also, of course, the language of stories, capable of articulating ways of life, relationships, atmospheres, modes of engagement, and most importantly, ethical issues. These are the stories of the traditional dwellers, of the historical dwellers, and also of the future dwellers, eventually taking the form of the programs architects and urban designers put forward for new modes of collective participation in the city of the future. This latter use of language is part of the architectural and urban project, as important, I would argue, as the drawings that may give it form. It has precedence, I'm not making this up, in the early modern works of Ledoux and Lequeux, more recently in the works of John Haydock. This language is emphatically not about algorithms. It is not about functions, but a vision of a poetic life for an idealized client, one should say, one that is thus related to its context in the proper sense. It is the language of the humanities and not one of hard science. It is deliberately a narrative language, keeping in mind Merleau-Ponty's observation that our fixation with calculation and universal languages of all sorts is a sure way to kill true language and human expression. The program for the new city, respectful of cultural identity, is a promise, and must be a promise of beauty and justice, terms that, as Elaine Scarry has shown, point to the same value rather than being antithetical. It is a promise born from the architect's responsible personal imagination through compassion for the other as a project for the common good. Thank you very much.
Superseding political ideologies and mere pragmatic considerations. So my question is, you've called upon mainstream practice to embrace this, and you've critiqued mainstream practice for not embracing this idea that architecture is the unfolding of beauty and truth, or beauty and justice, as you put it. And I wanted to know how you saw the role of the School of Architecture in persuading this notion of architecture's task as an unfolding of beauty and justice.
Well, you're very kind. It's a huge question. I've written an essay about architecture, this problem of architecture education. I don't even know how to start. I think most fundamentally, I mean, if I have to be pragmatic, I think the first thing is to stop feeling subservient to the mechanisms of production. You know, I have this wonderful anecdote from, I was honored by his friendship, John Haydock, who was telling me about one of these accreditation visits in Cooper Union, where they were very upset with him because he didn't, you know, have the checklist and whatever. He said, well, you should learn from me rather than me, you telling me what to do. And I think, you know, you really have to have this kind of vision. I mean, of course, because I think it needs, the way that we understand Design Studio, for example, all the problems that we give is not, this is of course a very general statement, it doesn't happen, I know, for example, of your work, but I know that in general, the attitude is really to run professional projects that are emulate practice. You know, and you choose a site and you give a program which is nothing more than a list of parts, and good luck, see you in a week and give me a couple of alternatives. Now, I think this is the wrong way to go about it. So I mean, it all starts there. It's how we teach studio. I think it's possible to understand through the arts, through the artifacts that have inherent meanings, because it's often difficult, for example, here to talk about something that is remote, like St. Peter's in Rome or whatever, right? But there are some things that can be made present that have emotive qualities, film, literature, that can be point of departure for these kinds of meditations. I mean, to give you an example of how, like when I was director at school in Carleton University, I was doing these kinds of things. On one hand, on the other hand, what is very important also is to give a serious place to architectural history and theory. Mm-hmm. Really serious place. Not just a veneer of culture and, like, you know, slides showing pictures of buildings or talking about styles, that's pretty useless. But to understand that in every case one can find questions that are resonant with ours. So when one is looking at history, but one is looking at history because it's relevant. And of course it's important for the professor to know how it's relevant to be able to communicate it. So I mean, this is to give you a couple of examples. Yeah. You know, and of course it's an education grounded in more in the humanities than in the hard science. Today we are so driven by production, everything is about instrumentality. So everything is about teaching the student how to you work with Beam and Revit. And you know, which is really kind of pathetic, if you ask me. Because then we miss the real issues. Of course, we prepare people to go out as workmen in the field for architects that cannot deal with a computer because they are like my age. But I don't know. That's a simple, like, short question, answer. But of course, there is a lot to talk about.
There is, yeah. Interested in extending that conversation or asking a new question related to what he's discussed? Yeah, I think I see a hand.
Well, there's something interesting you mentioned.
Yes, but I cannot hear you at all. This is a problem with acoustics. Do you want me to?
I'll make my voice bigger, maybe. Okay. There was something important you said about places informing culture, and you mentioned. You don't hear me?
I can.
You can hear me?
I'll just translate for you.
Okay.
So there's something important you mentioned about places informing culture. Yeah?
Yeah, and you gave an example of Uganda, where I come from, actually. And you are using Chicago to design Uganda. And so when I read the article about vision, it's called Visio Vent, it's transforming Kigali City into Chicago. Mm-hmm. And I took the two, and I don't think there's a connection between Chicago and Kigali, which is in Central Africa. So the vision is to rebuild Kigali to look like Chicago, instead of transforming Kigali to look like any African city. So that's where I picked you from, and I appreciate that you are against trying to transform New York, transform Kampala City in Uganda into a New York City. Does that make sense?
So he was talking about a city. He's from Uganda. This is my student on an end.
So you know, yeah.
Yeah. And he was talking about a city in Uganda that was. It sounds like the city planning was based on Chicago.
The city in Kigali is based on Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah.
So and the incongruence of that, the idea of dropping an American city inside Uganda.
Yes.
So he's complimenting your position on that. Do you have a question that you want to follow up?
You're very kind. Thank you. Yes, I think that would be absurd to do something like that.
So I was interested that you used the examples of Villa Maria, La Tourette, the Barcelona Pavilion to talk about projects that inherently
very different.
Very different and very, very much about the place. Yet you talked about how Norberg Schultz was a critic of and showed the shortcomings of the international style.
Yes.
How do we resolve those designers, those people working in these two ways? What was the crucial moment that you think they switched from the international style to this more critical work?
Well, I would say that it really depends on each one of these architects. They have a very different trajectory, and it really has to do a lot with their own professional way of working. Like in the case of Le Corbusier, that I know probably the best of the examples that I gave, I know that his practice as a painter every day, six days a week, really, he painted. And he wanted to be a painter, you know, he never worked for him. But he always took this very seriously, and his challenge was always to try to understand how something that worked spatially in painting could perhaps be translated into architecture to make something moving in architecture, but at the same time acknowledging that architecture cannot function in the same way as painting because you have to frame human action. And I think that only late in his life, after all this work, he found that it was not about making ramps through houses, but it was a completely different problem, you know, that I describe when I talk about La Tourette, for example. So each one of these architects does it, discovered in its own way. The question with Norbert Schultz is very clear, you know, that he was trying to respond to something. First of all, he wrote a book. His first book was very structuralist. He tried to do what they called Intentions in Architecture earlier. That was very much like a rewriting of modern Vitruvius that didn't go much very well anywhere, although became kind of well known. And then he discovered basically Heidegger and existential phenomenology, and this gave him an entry into this question of how the modernism, right, international style, had been disregarding the qualities of the places where these things were dropped. So that was the first moment in recent memory of ours, right, in which this problem of place is actually foregrounded, opposing it really to a concept of space, to this idea of modern space as something that you manipulate and that is objectified, that is a kind of Cartesian object with three coordinates, and that is universal from here to Uganda or Timbuktu, right? And so that was the first moment. But of course, this is not unprecedented. I mean, if you go back to early Greek philosophy, in a certain way, Aristotle has a problem with Plato's concept of hora, precisely for similar reasons, you know? So I think this really has its roots in Western philosophical history and the history of science as well, because when this starts to change, it's really with Galileo in the 17th century, but that would be a completely other lecture. But it is very interesting to point out that this is not just reason, except that for us, in our modernity, it's the first awareness of this is with Norbert Schultz. He puts it out there, makes these very famous books.
Hi. So I understand the concept that you're talking about language being quite important in imbuing meaning. I feel privileged. I'm a first-year grad student, and I have some great teachers who are imbuing our class with a lot of theory and things that go beyond program.
That's great.
So I think that's really great. The question I have, we're in a way we're taught to create the work and to be able to talk about the work, right? And my question is, if in talking about the work we're removing the poetry, if you can create something, but then if you have to explain it and why you did it, if that limits the ability of the piece to create its own life and own existence that can be interpreted by others.
Yes. No, I know this is true. But I'm not meaning the way that I mean language here is more at the generative stages of the project, both in the crafting of the program, which I think, you know, I don't think we give it a proper place in the architectural. I mean, if the architectural project is a promise to others, the program is fundamental because it's really your contribution through your own personal understanding and imagination, and that's what I mean. You have to have good cultural foundation, right, to be able to imagine a way of life for others, and so that's the first instance. So it's generative. I mentioned in passing, but it's of course, again, this will be another lecture, the work of Ledoux. Ledoux in the late 18th century is perhaps the first architect, because the world is changing so radically with the end of the old regime, basically the beginning of modernity. It's like the beginning of this country as well, right? The American Revolution, the French Revolution. It's complete change from a older understanding of things, where basically architecture had the possibility of simply reflecting the order of society or the cosmos, both, to be able to make sense for others, to create communicative spaces. When the world starts to change politically so dramatically, you know, with the Bill of like individual rights and freedoms, all these things that we take for granted, right? That is the beginning of our modernity. Ledoux immediately feels that he has to reinvent the possibilities of public life in a city by basically through language creating, imagining modes of interaction that would enable a new social contract, very much influenced by Rousseau, by the philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau. But that's why, you know, his book, it's a major, massive tome, which is the, the project for this city, ideal city of Sho, is really basically a project in words. There are images, but it's a project of life, for life. So I think ever since, there is this problematization of the program that becomes part of the project for the architect. So that's where I think, that's one instance where language is crucial. And the other thing, to see it very clearly, is that architects in the 18th century generally understood that architecture had to function like language for its expressive capacities. But with functionalism, with Durand, and later, the first thing that Durand tells his students is forget about the need to express anything. You just solve the functions, basically a problem of space planning, and the building will express itself. You don't have to involve words at all in the design process. It's a technical problem of solving through a drawing with a grid, what he calls the mechanism of composition, right? How you place the toilets and the corridors, and then this is extruded and expresses the building. You're not concerned with that as an architect. That's the beginning of functionalism. The reaction to that on the side of the École des Beaux-Arts is interesting because the architects say this is not enough. We have to defend our turf. We cannot be just like engineers. But what they do is they react pictorially by commandeering styles. This is a new thing also in the 19th century. The idea that the architecture is made of syntaxes, like Peter Eisenman talks about, this is a 19th century thing. Architects never thought of architecture as syntax, you know? And these syntaxes are, of course, visual. They stand for something ideologically, but they are visual. And so the artistic side reacts with pictures to the pictures of the engineering side. But it's all pictures. And that's been the situation for 200 years. Pictures that react to other pictures. So that's where you get the sense that there's something missing. I don't have all the answers. But how do you engage the linguistic imagination with, of course, the tools of the architect? We have to make architecture that ultimately we can draw, build, model and build. But you know, this is one of the big, I know that this is hard, but one of the fantastic things that John Haydock does, if you have the patience to look at his work, and I'm very lucky because I have a PhD student that just finished working 8 years on this, is really the yoking, the bringing together of the narrative and the drawing in some of the masks is absolutely unbelievable, right? He's working with language and withdrawing at the same time to design. It's not about describing something that you already have. Because I understand this problem, no? I mean, the work of architecture, the way it moves you is not about paraphrase. It's like a poem. If you could say what it means, why write it? You know, so you are absolutely right. The work of architecture, once it's out there, it's what it is. But it's language. As a generative, I'm always concerned with when I talk with problems of how we can engage these concepts for production, right? For our discipline. So that's the thought. And I've written about it, but there's a lot more to think about. Like, particularly, I'm very fascinated with how one can connect it to digital media, which is relatively unexplored. Because digital media are basically graphic. You know, software designed for engineers. I mean, give me a break. That's what we have. That's what we use. So there's other ways. But I don't think we're there yet. So it's not like kind of only like reactionary. I don't really, you know, because I really think that the tools we have now are pathetic. We haven't made much better things because we have digital tools. I don't think much has changed. But the problem is not the tool itself, you know. I would say that it starts really with this moment with the early 19th century. It drops off language. It's all pictorial, the design operation. Good. Yes. You want the microphone?
I don't know.
It helps.
So tell. It helps, okay. I think I have to go over this and think about it for a long time, but quickly I was trying to see the connection between phenomenology and hermeneutics that you mentioned, and I was wondering, I mean, this is another lecture, another seminar, but I was wondering if in the context of what you were describing about perception and conception, we would say that the phenomenology draws on the perception, and then hermeneutics comes in to add to the conception of. Because I think hermeneutics is language-based and phenomenology as visual and experience.
Yes.
And I guess I didn't think of them in the same lecture before. And since you're here and maybe you can help
clarify
some bridges.
Yes. Yes, I can try very briefly because it's a big problem. In fact, philosophers have done this, like Heidegger has a whole book where he connects the earlier existential problems of Dasein in Being and Time with the later concerns that we know better as architects, you know, the later essays like Building, Dwelling, Thinking. There is a whole book on hermeneutics. Basically, it's the place of language in the world of experience. That's how it gets started. So someone like Merleau-Ponty would say that language is actually part of the flesh of the world, because he would say, yes, because it's the flesh of the world is this element that unites, that basically, yes, that accounts for how human consciousness cannot be reduced to either the objective or the subjective, right? It's something that appears, for him is the first element, he says. Anyhow, language is in continuity with gesture. So it's emerging. It's not a code for hermeneutic phenomenology. Yes, this is really what the language is not a code. It's something that has to be understood as really a kind of, you know, at its roots. Particularly if you understand that consciousness is in continuity with life and that a cell has a modality of consciousness already when it goes for the grain of sugar that keeps it alive. Yes, it's already a mode of consciousness. And Aristotle would say that, you know, that we share this with animals. In the anima, he would say this. You know, it's really what we have is we share with the animals deeply. And for this reason, many cultures actually identify divinities with the animal, because that's really the sentience, which is a feeling. Okay, out of this, in continuity with this, is because we have a bigger brain, out of this consciousness emerges gesture which can be symbolic, not only the gesture that I use pre-reflectively to grab the bottle without thinking, but a gesture that I can say, hi, right? Or, yes, it's a symbolic gesture. This is all already almost like, hey, come here. So, The hermeneutic phenomenology understands language in continuity with lived experience. That's basically the bridge. And on the other side, well, yes, it has many consequences. So that language basically is not, and of course, this has to do also with the fact that meaning in general is not understood by phenomenology or hermeneutics as a semiotic condition, which is the way that most of us understand it. That meaning, you know, meaning is a pair of a signifier and a signified. In phenomenology, meaning is given in experience, already given in experience. There's already meaning there, so there is no break with language, you understand? Because phenomenology would say that even though I've never seen one like this before, I recognize this one specific thing as a bottle. And that's not something I do conceptually, it's given in experience. It's only when you have a pathology that you really operate like a computer and you say, ah, this is a container, I can open, I can drink from it, and therefore it's a bottle. You don't do that in your brain. You understand meaning so that the opening up of meaning into signifier and signified is a kind of artificial. condition. So that's the premise. If meaning appears in experience, then there is a continuity between the world of experience and the world of language. And ultimately, language is not arbitrary. That's why Heidegger can say, language speaks through us. We don't dominate it. Like when you ask me questions, you know, I mean, this is really like my gestures, my memory. If you, in a different context, I would not remember half of the things I'm telling you. Like I have very bad name memory for names, and it's everything is like that. So yes, if you talk Jeff Malpass, you could ask him this question. Jeff Malpass would say that place is primary for being, and that place and language are given together. So that's where the linguistic business is really interesting, right? Because you could argue, and I didn't talk about this model, but if you think about the Parthenon. Yeah, the Parthenon is this great rock, right? And it has all these temples, and we think, well, yes, this is place. Of course it's place. But what made it place in the first instance is a bunch of stories about two divinities that were, you know this very well, that were struggling for the tutelary, for to be the gods of Athens. And so there's this story about an abortive object that comes from heaven, falls on the rock, and it's dedicated to Athena, and then Poseidon, who was there earlier, gets upset, and they have this fight, and then Poseidon throws the trident, and it goes through. I mean, you can still see it in the erection, you know, where the trident went through, and where it hits the floor, and there it made a hole, and there was a well of salt water, and then Athena defended herself and threw her spear, and where it landed. An olive tree grew, so obviously, you know, belonged to Athena. So the story, right, the story makes the place. It's not because it's a big rock that I can touch and say, woo, magnetic. You know, it's not like that. The story makes the place. It may also be experiential, and there may be some magnetism, I don't deny it. Yeah, some people may feel this. But, you know, it's very important, this linguistic dimension of place. And it emerges, right? It's not made up. The other big concern, man, you give me opportunity to say these things. Yeah. Someone like Steiner, the linguist after Babel, right? He wrote this wonderful book called Real Presences, where he argues the connection really for him between hermeneutics and phenomenology is really the capacity we have to perceive the value of things in our tradition that move us, and to actually name this, because we tend to homogenize. We tend to think that this is all constructed, right? It's stories made up by political, for purposes of domination or control or whatever. But what he's arguing is that in our historical traditions, certain things move us and certain things don't. And it's not all the same. To think that Mozart is the same as any other mediocre composer, contemporary of Mozart, it's not to do justice to our experience of the thing. So in that sense, a hermeneutic understanding of history, when you're doing research into history, means that you are valorizing the experiential content, how things feel, how they move you personally. And if you do that, you can actually, I think, as a teacher, teach much better. You know the things that really matter to you. It's not just a logical thing. You know, it's really at the level of Greek aesthesis, which is an emotional knowledge, right? Multisensory, not the aesthetic of the 18th century, which is really kind of detached. Right? It's a misunderstanding of the problem of aesthetics. So it's really about something that moves you. So in that sense, hermeneutic methodology for historical understanding is connected to the experiential dimension of the work. So you learn to you have to acknowledge that something is better than other, that a freshman paper on Shakespeare by some clever student is not really writing like Shakespeare is writing, and that this is not something we've just made up because Shakespeare was the friend of the queen, you know? It's something that really exists because what moves us matters. And because cognition is not only here, it's here as well. It's connected, you know, and neuroscientists now emphasize this, that cognition without emotion is impossible. Someone like Antonio Damasio, that wrote this book called Descartes' Error. So I think it's all, that's the connection with phenomenology.
Thank you very much.